guys didn't even produce Basic Instinct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Still, we respect it. How are you guys?
Good. Happy.
Good.
You've had a pretty good year already, even before Divergent opens to massive numbers of dollars. Moulin Rouge turned out to be...
Gatsby.
See, and I'm going back to Moulin Rouge. But Gatsby turned out to be a massive hit.
Yeah. Yes, yes. It was very... We were thrilled with what happened with it.
Surprised, did you kind of know that it was going to be much better than... The concerns about the delay led people to think?
No, the delay was a very willful choice because the work Baz was doing on the music, everyone was so excited and he just needed more time. Mm-hmm. But it was different having a living author on this one. You get, you know, it's a different relationship. It's a little easier with F. Scott Fitzgerald.
on Divergent.
On Divergent, Veronica being a...
Yeah. So has she become part of your producing team or is that, how does that work?
You know, she is because she's extraordinary. And if you've done this well, you're always anxious about the book author. And there's all kinds of stories mm-hmm. about good experiences, bad experiences. She's just so open and lovely that from the first time she came into the office in Chicago and she would start to see architectural drawings of the pit, she'd kind of look around and go, oh, that's really cool. Or she was so lovely about other people's creativity. Mm-hmm. So the costumer, who's a real artist, sort of saying, oh, that erudite costume. Yeah, great idea, yeah. She made it really fun and she hence became a resource for the movie.
So not picking your nits.
No, exactly.
And how did you guys hook up in the first place? Did you just buy the book or how did you guys start on this?
Oh, someone's... This is really LA because you can smell someone smoking marijuana very strong. It's wafting through. So is this for anyone not in California? This is what we're smelling.
Or you should put this in smell-o-vision.
Yeah, smell-o-vision. We read the manuscript very early before the book came out, and with no sense of whether or not it would be a phenomenon, but just that it was a very compelling story with incredible action adventure and a really original heroine.
And was it, I mean, is everybody kind of like looking for that thing now? It seems like now it's become a genre unto itself almost.
Well, a lot of things failed because someone just said, I'm going to try and copy that genre. The things that are actually real books, real movies in their own right seem to be having a pretty good life. So this was always about a real movie as opposed to some trying to ride some trend.
Yeah, we read it and it could have been a standalone book, you know. Mm. Then we were happy that it had a sequel, which came out after we had bought the book, and so we hadn't even read the sequel when we bought the book. And then the third book came out when we were shooting the movie, so it wasn't like it already was this pre-existing franchise. It was a manuscript by an unknown author, so it was really fun to watch it evolve too.
So you guys, I guess the screenplay came first before Neil?
Yes.
And so, how long a process was that for you?
It was a long process. It's a complicated adaptation, because you both have to explain a whole new world to the audience, make sure you keep the emotional thrust, and where it's sort of an extraordinary story is you're both doing a very personal story of empowerment of a shy girl who's never left home, who's suddenly becoming a warrior, and at the same time trying to sort of tell a giant action. Coup story. So that took a lot of work to try and get the right balance for the movie.
And was the script, once you guys figured out, once you cracked that, was it pretty much locked in at that point, or were you, is this an ongoing process to production and everything else?
Very, very ongoing. We had a structure that was solid, but it continued to evolve, because even another complexity is The Sims. You know, you have a world where you get to look inside, see people face their worst fears. So just to sort of say, what does that look like visually? How does that fit in with the world we're creating? And how does it move the story forward? That was a lot of challenges.
There are a lot of subplots, and we wanted to keep all the subplots. Or we thought we wanted to keep all the subplots. Then when we were trying to juggle all the subplots, it was difficult. So we actually kept writing all the way through the all the way through the shooting. We even were writing just to sort of try to keep each of these aspects alive because we had a lot of characters to serve, and we have a big cast, and we love the cast. The cast is amazing. So,
a lot of DVD extras, or
yes,
will they wait till the third film comes out, and then they'll package them as a?
That's right. If they want to see someone's eye poked out, they can see the DVD extras.
We have a lot of extras of behind the scenes. We don't have a lot of footage that we shot that isn't in the movie, actually. Mm-hmm. We do have a few things, though.
So the decision to get Neil was, I mean, another... I mean, it seems now that people are finding filmmakers who are not necessarily the big visual guys, but are actually filmmakers and interested in character first. How did you guys come to that decision?
We spoke with a lot of directors. The script was good. And again, we, you know, approaching it like a real movie, Neil's a serious filmmaker, and he came in with a real clear sense of what the challenges were, what the opportunities were. Even, for example, something, he was very smart about how to create a grounded world that wouldn't feel arbitrary, wouldn't feel sci-fi, would really feel like life.
And I gather you shot almost the entire thing in Chicago, yes?
Yes, we shot the entire thing in Chicago, except a little bit of additional shooting that we did in L.A. after Kate Winslet had a baby.
Hard decision to go and actually shoot a location, or was that...
We always wanted to. Chicago doesn't have as big a rebate as some other states, so that was a little bit of an issue, because it's such a major part of the book. It also helps ground the book and make the characters feel they're in a real setting to be there. Mm-hmm. So we made a lookbook for the studio of how beautiful Chicago was and what we were going to feature, and they actually said okay very quickly, even though it was more money to shoot there, just because it did establish it as its own visual entity in a way that differentiated from other sci-fi things and other futuristic things and other dystopian things. It made it much more original, and Veronica was very happy, and the mayor, the governor, they all came to thank us and thank for the extra jobs. So,
well, I'm guessing the alternatives would be Detroit and Toronto. Would that be the other?
Or Atlanta.
Atlanta.
Or Atlanta. And you'd be shooting for Chicago in those cities if you had done it?
Yes.
Take out Chicago?
Yeah, yes. We shot Long Island in Australia for the Great Gatsby. So we're no strangers. But no, it was a real luxury shooting in Chicago. Because again, the movie, it made the movie feel grounded, it made it feel like a real place. The audience gets bored of computer worlds that don't feel in any way resonant. And the other luxury about it is that you've got an ensemble. All the actors are living in the same hotel, sometimes the young ones getting into real trouble there. But aside from that, you sort of build an ensemble. It's like a theater company going to work, and that's a great way to keep everyone focused on the story.
So is it fun to go to a place like Chicago? I mean, Chicago's a great city.
We loved it. We had an apartment overlooking the lake. Fantastic food. We loved hanging with the cast. Like Doug said, they were all in this landmark building called the Aqua. It had many police visits late at night. My favorite story being when the police came one night because they were partying too much, and one of the actors said, "Oh, but it's our weekend," because it was a Tuesday night. Maybe your weekend. It's nobody else's weekend.
I always remember in Chicago, there's a place called the Chicago Inn, I think, and it's like right over near Miracle Mile, near the Michigan Avenue, and it's there's a strip club that's in a more kind of warehousey district, but all the girls from the strip club, they bring in girls from out of town all the time, like 30, 40 of them at a time, live in this very quiet little hotel in the neighborhood, and you're like, wow, what is that? What's that be like? But now we know with actors.
No, it's a great city, and one of the benefits of the way the rebate has taken over the movie business is you get to visit a lot of cool places.
Yeah, the California lack of rebate is sort of the Visit America program for producers and actors.
Is it hard? I mean, there's all that talk about this now and whether California's going to ever do anything about it. But I mean, has that become kind of the standard? You kind of have to really think about other places?
You begin thinking, because basically you're in a conversation where if it's a $6 million difference, do you want to put that on screen? You know, what are the benefits? We did some additional shooting in Los Angeles, the only stuff we didn't do in Chicago, and the DP everybody said, this is so exciting. It's like the old days shooting in Los Angeles. I get to go home for dinner.
We're desperate for them to bring back the movie business here, but meanwhile, we get to see many places.
Yeah. So did you hook up with a studio quickly, or was that from the early process?
We took the manuscript to a few places, a few of which passed, weren't interested. And then Lionsgate came in very aggressively, and they were a great partner.
Why did they pass? Because, you know, company passed on Twilight also. Paramount passed on Twilight, and it seems like insanity at this point.
Well, it always, in retrospect, seems obvious. Uh-huh. But, you know, there's a famous story. Someone actually wrote a letter passing on E.T., and the letter was passed around for a long time. So, you know, at the time, it was a challenging new manuscript. Mm. There was no sense of if it would be a publishing sensation. And I think for a lot of people, it seemed a little, they didn't quite get it. Mm-hmm. And Summit had a real understanding of great stories that might involve a younger protagonist. Mm-hmm. So there was a kind of openness to them. And
we were bought by Summit, and then Summit was bought by Lionsgate. So,
and does the merger affect you very much at all? I mean, I guess there's some other people you have to deal with, but
well, no, we got people. You know, we've known John Feltheimer for a long time. We just got more smart people to help open the movie.
More people on the team.
Yeah.
So, how critical was the choice of Shalane?
Everything. She's in every frame of the movie. She literally is, except for the very opening when you sort of see the fact that she's in every frame of the movie. She never had one day off. She didn't even have 2 hours off. So, she was. We knew we were going to have somebody who could carry the entire movie, and mm-hmm. it's a complicated part because she has to start off abnegation and demure and too shy to even look in the mirror, and then she has to end up a warrior who can take on the smartest person in the world, who also won an Academy Award and is a great actress. So we knew she was going to be toe to toe with. We were hoping to get Kate Winslet. We didn't have Kate yet, but mm-hmm. we got Kate soon afterwards. So we knew it was somebody who had a big job, and we thought we were going to go meet every cool actress in the world, because mm-hmm. Doug had produced Working Girl and Girl Interrupted and The Craft, and done Memoirs of a Gate. We'd done lots of searches for girls, but we literally met Shailene, and it was like, okay, job done, she's perfect. So that was that.
It doesn't seem like there's a very long list of possible people, or was the option of going with somebody who had no real history?
It's not always an option, because there's so many young actors in the world, and somewhere there's another Shailene, another Jennifer Lawrence, so you're always making sure you're doing your due diligence about the best person for the part. Shailene just emerged quickly as such a perfect fit. It was almost as if she was created to be Triss, so that was very convenient.
And it would seem like she's a good person to have with that kind of pressure on her on a show like this, because she's so divergent herself.
Yes, and she's had a lot of experience starting as a young actor, but her greatest contribution was we're in an epic movie, a lot of action and adventure. She's such a truth seeker that she makes every moment real. So it's always, this is what the person would really do if a knife were being thrown at their head. This is how a person would really behave if there were soldiers all around them about to attack their family. She just makes everything true.
So this was all kind of a mystery in terms of the franchise of it all when it started. I mean, as it became more apparent that it was something that was growing, was there more pressure on you guys?
I would say it was more like being in a sailboat at sea.
Well, you say pressure.
I say more like being in a sailboat at sea when the wind comes. Mm-hmm. It was mostly opportunity. Because if you love a movie, the worst thing that can happen is there's not an audience for it. Mm-hmm. And so as the book surged, as it spoke to more people, you always knew that if the movie worked, it was going to have a real chance in the marketplace.
But you have that moment where you're at dinner and you go, oh, we got one. We got it. Because you guys have made some very big movies, but you've never, I mean, Stuart Little had a second film, but you haven't really made films that are, you know, franchises as such.
We still don't say it till afterwards.
You're going to wait till the third film or fourth film?
Obviously the first one had to work or none of it mattered. And no, we're actually having fun with the second one because we've never quite been in this opportunity where you suddenly say, okay, we've got all the exposition done. We understand our characters. Now we get to explore them more, try things we didn't do, build on what's already been created.
And it was fun to work with Summit Lionsgate because they were so, because of Hunger Games and Twilight, they were so familiar with how that would work. In fact, just making the deals, because we have such a gigantic cast, and many of them aren't well known yet, and they will be well known very soon, and some of them will be starring in their own movies, like Jai Courtney will star in The Terminator, and Miles Teller star in Fantastic Four, and Shailene is obviously in Nanceler and Fault. You know, they're all over the place, but I forgot what I was going to say. I had a point, sorry.
It was good to have the support of somebody who'd been there before.
Oh, yes. Making the deals because we had to be able to have people available for three movies. So anybody that was going to be signed up to be in a television show, we'd have to be able to work around knowing that there could be three movies, even though we didn't even have the first one yet. Mm-hmm. We had to have people that could be available. So it's hard to find somebody that is a really good actor, but will be able to sign up for that many times ahead of time. That much of a commitment time-wise. Right. So that was, there were quite a few people that we looked at, but then there was no way to juggle. They were already in a series or something like that. And Theo, in fact, was in a series, which luckily for us, vanished.
Well, I haven't read the books, I'm embarrassed to say. Not that embarrassed, but I'm embarrassed to say. But are you going to be able to shoot spring, summer in Chicago each time? Is that the, or does it change?
I think we go to a different world in the next one. We start in Amity, which is more rustic, rural, so we have a little more room to figure out where we're going to shoot it.
So that's an open question at
yes.
this point?
Yes, yeah.
And is the idea of spreading out to a fourth film, is that even an issue, or is that
we
another
haven't
question for another year?
That's
another
a question for after a few cocktails.
and you've had your share already of internet abuse over Mr. Schwenke being hired for the next film. Who's a terrific filmmaker, but he did run into a bomb. Was that even an issue? Is it just you're going to look for the guy who can do the work, and that's all that matters?
Yes, and as a matter of fact, Robert came in with such a point of view, swept us all off our feet. We had a terrible crunch finishing one movie, trying to get another one started. So also, a lot of times when people from our experience, a lot of times when a director's coming off a disappointment, the next one they'll knock out of the park because there's just something about an extra level of consideration. So that was almost oddly a plus. We've had that occur several times where it really worked for the movie.
You had it occur on Gladiator. Ridley had a few disappointing movies, and then of course he's hugely talented and he came back with a vengeance on Gladiator. So
yeah, I'm always amazed when they decide to write people off in this town. Yeah. Then they come back with their biggest film or a whole new career.
Well, also, again, with someone like Robert, if you talk to him, he's a really smart, talented guy. Mm-hmm. So if you were really lazy and just said, oh, this movie didn't work and didn't do some homework on what happened, what didn't, then you're just a fool. Because at the same time, sometimes people will take a filmmaker, give them too much power or control after a success, not knowing that was a little lucky.
Right.
So
you saw those last summer too.
Yeah.
So do you, I mean, is there anything that you have to concede to what this now seems to be becoming? I mean, obviously you haven't had opening day yet, but there's this sense that there's another monster in the field here. Or is that just the job of producer anyway?
I'd say one of the things that kind of haunts us is the actors are going to have their lives changed so much, and they all were free-spirited, could walk down the street, could do whatever they wanted, and that's already changed. They now need security and things like that. Mm-hmm. So seeing that, I'd say that's a sort of bittersweet. You're happy because they want to have the careers that they're going to have now, and yet their privacy is going to be impinged on in a way that maybe wasn't the allure for them in the first place, but it's the side effect. So kind of knowing that if the more this succeeded, the more their lives were going to change, hopefully for the better in many respects, but also in some ways different, and their privacy would be definitely diminished.
Yeah.
So hopefully they won't mind.
I guess it's hard for Jennifer Lawrence to go get mail at her in her underwear or whatever, her pajamas, anyone.
Yeah, I think it. And all of our actors are very, they're all human beings. They're funny. They're smart. They're not wanting to not have a life. So I hope they get to. So everybody, I hope they get to keep their lives.
And if you're around for a while, and it's funny, the Summit people were so smart about how they advised the actors about what might come, and they started with the good stuff. They said, you're going to be able to do unbelievable work for any charity you want. You can really make a difference. You're going to be able to get movies made that no one else can get made. And now you're going to need some new issues, some security issues, some privacy issues, and then kind of gave them the whole package of what to expect.
It was also interesting for them to have Kate Winslet's perspective, because she did Titanic when she was their age, and she does have a great life. So it was interesting because she's not that old herself now, but she actually has been there exactly where they couldn't walk down the street.
So they're all going to move out of L.A.? Is that what you're saying? You're all going to move to some suburb of London and come back just to work
occasionally?
No, I didn't.
Much easier. Well, that, I think that actually, that's been my experience with actors who are going through that process, that it often is like, get out of here. Leaving town is kind of like the first stop for a lot of them, because it's hard to do it when you're in a company town. You know, New York is easier than here, which is kind of surprising in a way, but it seems to be. But it's tough.
On the other hand, you see people ruined in every city. Plenty in New York, plenty in London. So it seems like it's just those people who are lucky to have some group around them, have some inner fiber.
Back
to your question, it is nice to make a movie that people already know what it is before you finish the movie, so you're not having to create something from nothing in terms of the public perception, which was nice for us with Gatsby. People already loved the book, they already wanted to see the movie. And same with this, it always says highly anticipated before they say the word Divergent. So people, instead of saying, what does Divergent mean, they're going, oh, it's highly anticipated.
Well, it's funny, because I mean, I remember when Twilight got the EW cover in the summer before it came out, it was kind of considered a huge deal that, you know, why they made a choice, or EW had made a choice and was kind of getting ahead of the curve. Nowadays, it's like there's this assumption attached to it that it's going to be that.
Well, yes and no, because as you know, because whenever there's a few movies that don't work, everyone scrutinizes much more carefully, and they're saying, is this a real movie or not? I think luckily we've entered the category of a real movie.
So how does this affect you guys as producers? You got a lot of stuff in development still and projects you'd like to do. Are you going to be stuck, so to speak, for 3 years or 4 years? Or are you going to be able to keep making things while you're making this?
Well, partly. I mean, partly this. I mean, on Insurgent, we have Akiva Goldsman, who's an old friend and one of the best writers in Hollywood, working Robert Twankey. So there's a great deal of pleasure in that. It's fun. So we're having fun with that. We're talking about, you know, world-class visual artists, talking about what else you can do with a sim and what that would be like. So so far pretty fun. And as far as other things, you know, you can't rush stories. So other things are being written. If they turn out great, they'll get made quickly. Usually they turn out a little bit less great and you work harder and it takes longer.
We've worked on more than one movie at a time many times in our career. So we have, the year that I joined Doug, in fact, he was doing four movies. He was producing four movies in 1 year. And they were Gladiator, Stuart Little, Hollow Men, and Girl Interrupted all in the same year. So sometimes we've been lucky and been able to do, you know, one with the left hand and one with the right hand, and hopefully not shooting at the same time.
So we might see Bye Bye Birdie before 2020.
I hope so.
It might happen.
Someday. Could you sing one of the songs for us, just to kind of...
Scarily enough, I know all the songs. It's just, you have to decide whether you want to be Paul Lind or Dick Van Dyke. Can you guys know the score quite well, I assume, by now?
We do.
Yes.
Did you develop a musical like that? I mean,
We had it, and we put it on hold, and we might revisit it.
But I mean, the script is not bad to start with.
No.
It doesn't require a lot of development.
Well, except you forget how much it's about the older characters. You remember the movie more about the younger, but the play is actually very much about the old people with a few, you know, about songwriting and getting some young, dumb singer to do it.
So now that you guys are hitting your 40s, is that more challenging?
It's just parts and challenges next year or two.
But I mean, it's true of also Divergent. I mean, it's a movie for teenagers and for 20-somethings primarily. They're going to have an audience beyond that, but you know, you're making a movie for the kids, so to speak. Is that get more challenging as you get to be adults?
No, because you make the movie for yourself. So there's so many. I mean, Neil Berger is a totally real filmmaker. So you're, you know, Kate Winslet, one of the best actors in the world. So you're just saying, can we make a great movie? You know, there's a young protagonist. How do you do the world creation? It's just all the same struggle to get something to be good.
We make sure our kids like the movie too.
And if they've seen it, I assume.
Yeah, they were on set a bunch of times, and they've seen it a few times.
So you got the big thumbs up from.
We got one as an extra, an Air United extra.
Did she get cut, or did she make
no? It? She made it to. She's cut out of Gatsby. She made it into Divergent.
Sam Mendes, when we were doing a movie with him, used to call them the firing squad, because they would come in. We'd ask the kid appointment on different screen tests, and they were, you know, kids are really direct about ooh or wow.
Yes, kids are all. Now I'm forgetting the name of the group. What's the group that she's in? She chooses.
Oh, the Dauntless.
The Dauntless. Kids are all Dauntless, I think.
Yes,
pretty much.
And with a little candor, too.
A little candor.
A little candor.